So we had a question from a viewer, Suvan Shah. And his question is that, Jay Bhai, it is clear that the mind and the body are changing constantly. Every time we walk, eat, breathe, our mind is filling up with new experiences and our body is either losing or gaining matter. It is, if this is the case that our mind and our body are never the same, yet being, our I, remains the same throughout our lives. How can our being be the same as our mind and body?
You see, it's an interesting question to explore right at the start. Because you see, if you really analyze, if you analyze our system, of course, the body, all the cells are being kind of replaced all the time. Your whole body is recreated almost on a monthly basis. So all the bodily cells are shifting. Some are dying and new ones are being formed. And so the body is always in a constant flux. And mind is even worse. It's in an even greater flux because we kind of get bombarded with so many interesting experiences that kind of keeps changing our mind, altering our mind all the time. So if that is the case, why do we feel that the I is still the same? Because the body and the mind that we kind of use seem to be changing all the time. Why doesn't the I also keep shifting, you know? This is a good thing to explore. In fact, this is how Ramana Maharshi, that great master of modern India, was suggesting to the people who visited him. They said, my friend, ask yourself, who is this I? The body is changing, the mind is changing, your intellectual capacity keeps changing. So exactly what is this I that seems to remain constant? I mean, since I was born, and even now, I don't feel the I has moved at all. It's just the same I. So what is actually the reason why the I seems to remain the same? And the answer lies in the spiritual realm, not in the material or mental realm. And that is why this question is very, very interesting. Because if you want to just analyze yourself, exactly who am I? Because the body is all in a constant flux, the mind is in a flux. How can I possibly have continuity? That continuity is the spirit. That's the one that is unchanging, underpinning, the witness to all the vagaries of the mind and the body. And yet it is not changing because it is the witness and not what is being witnessed. Now, this is nice to talk as a kind of idyllic way of explaining philosophy of Hinduism, highest philosophy. But in reality, to put it into practice needs tremendous effort to see yourself separate from the vagaries of your body and mind. It is very, very difficult. But that is the whole process of spiritual kind of enlightenment. So once you start to see yourself as the subject, sakshi, rather than the thing that is being observed, including your body and mind, then you become truly spiritual because now you've discovered that your essential nature, unchanging, is the spirit, and that is, if you like, appears as unchanging thing that you call I. So Ramana Maharshi used to tell all the people who asked him, how do I progress? He said, just find out what is this I. Just keep focusing, who the heck is this I? And if you keep focusing on this I, then the externals that are kind of clouding your vision, your body and the mind, stops interfering. And you will come to the conclusion that you are the observer of all these phenomena and not part of the phenomena.
Brilliant. Folks, thank you so much for joining us today. We've got lots of questions and comments already coming in through. What I'd like to say is, if you like the broadcast, if you're enjoying the question and answers, please feel free to share with your friends and family. Give us a thumbs up or a like. And what I'm going to be doing is, whilst Jay Bhai is answering your questions, I will be live online trying to answer all your queries and comments. So Jay Bhai, the next question is from a viewer, Satwik Pai, and he's asking that he watched one of your videos, which is titled, Is Seeking Moksha Selfish? And in which you talked about how one can attain moksha in the grahastha ashram, that is by gradually expanding the sphere of people whom he or she cares about. Now, Satwik was not able to understand how that would help a person understand his true identity as Atman and his relation to his surroundings. He still sees everybody as different persons and there is nothing in common between them. So, could you share some light for him and help him understand this?
Indeed, it's a very interesting, again, this is a very good question to explore. Why? Because, you know, I say that, look, even if you are in the grahastha ashram, leading a very mundane life, a very, you know, householder stage life, then you say, how can you possibly make spiritual progress in that state? This is how you do it. This is a beautiful thing to explore. It says, you see, first of all, be active. This is the first rule. Always be active. Never be passive and sit back and lie back and become a couch potato. Always become more proactive. That's the first part that stirs you up. But then when you are being active, most of us are active, if you like, in a very self-centered manner. Haven't you noticed? I mean, every activity, suppose I want a cup of tea, or it's just for me to make my tea and put it in my mouth. So everything we do is kind of self, you know, kind of directing itself to the ego, this I that I'm so sure about. Now, when you are living in the grihastha ashram, I said expand the people you call your own, and then you'll soon begin to recognize you are not what you think, but you are the Atman. How does that happen? Very good answer. The answer is this. It says, really, when you start putting yourself on the back burner and think about the good, the betterment of others, for the betterment of other, your family members, your social the people in your society, etc., what is happening is this. You are rubbing away the notion that this I is this ego, because that ego is now has been left behind, is being given the final last position. Because you put the ego on the back burner, in a way you are rubbing off this kind of wrong impression that you are the ego. So by trying to expand the activities for the betterment of greater good, for greater society, greater humanity, your ego left behind. And this constant, not just believing it, but actually constantly practicing it, putting it into practice. The activity you do somehow are not self-centered, but kind of, you know, centered for great goodness, of, for the betterment of greater humanity. Once you start practicing this, not just believing in it, actually putting it to practice, you actually like, yeah, I want to do something for this guy, I want to sort this out, I want to help these people. That activity, in a way, will slowly rub away this thing that is sticking to you like a glue, you know, this ego. And that gets rubbed off. The more you do, not just believe, but actually act in that manner, selfless manner, the more you act in that manner, the more you rub away the ego that is blocking your view regarding your true identity as the Atman. So these selfless activities is not for the betterment of others. Let me tell you, it's for your own betterment in a way. It's the most selfish thing you're doing, because by trying to rub away your ego, you're really focusing your own self-interest in that sense. And yet, that is a way to recognize your true divinity as the Atman. So never stop doing it. And in the grihastha ashram, you can put it into practice in a great way, because you got the opportunity. You got the wealth to do that. You got the ability to do that because you are a householder. So you got access to all these kind of extra resources. And you can use these resources for the betterment of greater world. And more you do it, the more kind of closer you get to the idea that I am not this little tiddly fellow. I am the Atman. I am the spirit looking out.
Thank you for sharing that, Jay Bhai. Makes it quite easier to understand the whole concept. We have a question from a viewer, Sheikh Miraji, He's a Muslim gentleman who's talking about the suggestion that animal sacrifice is okay as per Manusmriti. So he says, Swayambhu, or the self-existent, himself created animals for the sake of sacrifices. Sacrifices have been instituted for the good of this world, hence the slaughtering of beasts for sacrifice is not just ordinary slaughter. So would you be able to share some light on this?
Indeed. You see, you can see, this is unfortunately the case. When anybody from other religion or no religion wish to vilify Hinduism, they'll pull out the Manusmriti. Now, I told you, Manusmriti is a Shastra, means scripture of lower authority. It's a contextual text. Also, it was applicable perhaps 1,000, 1,500, 2,000 years ago. It has not been applicable for about 1,000 years since Ramanujacharya kind of stood up against it, saying nonsense. So Manusmriti is an outdated Shastra, injunctions for society. At some stage, perhaps the Hindus also thought it's fine to kind of sacrifice animals, you can go to higher heavens. And that's what Buddha discovered and ran away from Hinduism, saying this is horrible. How can you go to higher heaven by sacrificing animals? So they, in fact, this is an outdated scripture. And when people want to find flaws in Hinduism, they'll pull the Manusmriti out. In every chapter, they'll find certain verses that will offend the Hindus, modern Hindus, saying, this can't be us, surely. And the same applies to this particular quotation he's giving from the Manusmriti.
Brilliant. So, folks, thank you so much for joining us. We have a lot of comments on YouTube. Please bear with me. I will be coming around to answering so many of your questions and so on. If you are on Facebook, remember, you can always go over to youtube.com/HinduAcademy. Like and subscribe, hit the bell icon so we can notify you of the future uploads. We've got almost 2,000 videos there for your viewing pleasure, and they are organized. Some of them, I would suggest you start with the playlists that have been made on the channel. It's a great place to start. And if you're on YouTube, thank you so much for joining us. Please do consider sharing the conversation on Facebook at facebook.com/HinduAcademy. Now, Jay Bhai, moving swiftly on, we have a question from Uma Patel, and she's saying, I have married into a cultish movement, a family who believe that only one form of God to be supreme and all the others to be demigods. What can I say to a devotee of this movement who challenges my beliefs to be wrong?
Yes, okay, Uma, you must stand your ground. The Hinduism tells you to always stand your ground in what you believe. First of all, let me tell you, our tradition is a pluralistic tradition. We recognize lots of different pathways for making spiritual progress. And we recognize that different communities, different societies, different families might subscribe to one particular vision of the ultimate reality and focus on it. Is that wrong? No, we wish them well. The only thing we say is this. If you think a particular deity is suitable to your own background and you like your tremendous devotion to the particular deity, you are lucky. In that case, my friend, I would say, you should tell the people who are challenging you, say, please carry on focusing on the deity that you love so much, and I wish you well. Progress to your destination, earlier the better, faster you go. We wish you well. At the same time, please do not impose your deity on us, because we've got our own way of thinking about ultimate reality, and it is not the same as yours. So do not denigrate people of, you know, people who like to believe in a different deity. Do not denigrate anybody. Don't call anybody demigod. Suppose I love Shiva, would I say he's a demigod? How dare I? So people have different deities that they subscribe to. Our advice is very simple. If you love that deity, good luck to you. You are very fortunate. Please go to your destination. We wish you well. But do not interfere in our way of unfolding spiritually, in the way that we kind of relate to the ultimate reality, either as a personality that we love or as a principle that we like to understand. So please do not let them infringe on your freedom to decide on which pathway suits your own temperament. And be outright and very clear, saying we are a pluralistic religion. Just quote them. Ekama satta vipra bahudha vadanti, from Rig Veda. Many different ways of relating to ultimate reality. Yours is the thing that suits your own temperament. Good for you. That's a nice example I use. You know, different mommy will cook different food for different children, depending on their digestion system. If it's a baby, she might just kind of pulp it and then, you know, feed the baby. It's a bit grown up, might give it crunchy food. So just as different people have different digestion system, different youngsters have different digestion system, and the mother will prepare the food suited to their own digestion system. In the same way, this ultimate reality has produced a variety of different ways of digesting spiritual ideas. Not that one is better than the other. Depending on your own level of growth, you will adopt the method that suits your own temperament. We wish you well. Don't impose it. Don't make it universal. Always allow others to progress in their own way. In the same, I'm saying that not only in the Hindu tradition, but even people of other tradition who are quite genuine and sincere in their pathway, we wish them well. We think they are on the right path. Just go to your destination. Don't impose your pathway on others. They've got their own pathway.
Brilliant. Jaybhai, just so that some of the viewers can go back over this thing, could you explain the difference between monotheism, polytheism and pluralism?
Indeed, very good. You see, when you want to focus on the ultimate reality as a mono, means a single ultimate reality, theos means God, one ultimate supreme personality. Suppose, you know, Hindus might say Mother Goddess or Shiva or Vishnu as ultimate reality. They want to focus on that. This is called monotheism. In the Christian tradition, they say it's Christ or the Father in heaven, monotheist God. So, and so on. So different religions will also think about ultimate reality in a personalized manner, is a single personality called monotheism. This is the language. Then there is other word is polytheism, means belief in lots of ultimate realities. Now this is, many want to criticize Hindus. They say Hindus are like that. They are polytheists. They believe in lots of ultimate reality, lots of gods and goddesses. It is not true. We believe in the same ultimate, but we recognize that it has got different names and forms. This is called pluralism. So from the word polytheism, it is not Hinduism. It is in fact pluralism. Many different ways, different names and forms we give to the ultimate reality. Now this is pluralism. There's one other word I want to introduce for the first time. It's called henotheism. You may not have heard the word. Henotheism means, suppose I love, for example, Vishnu. I'll say, okay, Vishnu is the supreme god. Now I can't denigrate the other gods. So let's say, well, there's a bit of a hierarchy. So Vishnu says, oh, Brahma, you are the creator. Oh, Shiva, you are the destroyer. So it's called henotheism. Means my god is a little bit better than the other gods. But I don't fight about it. I simply say he's got a superior position, you know, higher position. There's a bit of positioning. But I mean, as a pluralist, I just agree with me. I say, if you like Shiva, Shiva is your creator, preserver, and destroyer. So always recognize the variation within Hinduism. But the most powerful word is pluralism, many ways. And this comes from the ancient scripture, Rig Veda. And also, this is the only way people of many different religions or people within the same religion can coexist with each other without thumping each other. Pluralism is a solution. Even in the same religion, people blow each other up. How do you solve it? Pluralism. This is your way. Suppose I'm a Protestant and I say I want everything very simple cut. And I don't want this ritualistic thing, the liturgy and all that. I'm a Protestant. Good enough for you. Suppose I say I'm a Catholic. I love all this colorful liturgy and candles and waving sticks and all that. that's good for you. So that's again fine. So even the fighting between Protestants and Catholics can be resolved by recognizing pluralism is the resolution of interfaith dialogue as well as intrafaith dialogue. Please recognize the power of our teaching.
Brilliant. Thank you so much for sharing that, Jay Bhai. So, Jay Bhai, the next question we've got is quite an interesting one. It's a modern era question. So, are live-in relationships and premarital physical intimacy allowed in Hinduism? And is there any mention, so this is the second question.
Yes.
Is there any mention on how society should treat single mothers? And the third question is, why are girls supposed to be maintaining their virginity and it is not mandatory for boys? That's before marriage.
See, these are the kind of questions I'd like to explore. Why? Because these are the kind of issues that bother modern Hindu youngsters today. And we must respond to it. First of all, our tradition is not a prescriptive religion. Some religions are prescriptive. Everything is fixed, written in the book. You can't challenge it. You can't argue about it. You have to follow it to the letter. We don't have any such book. Can you believe this? We simply say, basic things we say are this, that look, anything that takes you back to your own nature is considered to be good. Anything that takes you away from your true nature, we consider to be bad. It's very commonsensical. It surpasses the idea of a prescriptive religion. So, for example, today, suppose something I do which makes me feel I'm the spirit, I'm Atman, that's good for me. But tomorrow, perhaps that particular activity doesn't make me feel like that, then it's no longer valid. Now, these questions are very direct and very pointed. As we are not a prescriptive religion, we are saying really the best thing to do is to use your own common sense to make sense of these kind of issues. Suppose you've got a very loving relationship with a partner and you're not married, but the relationship is very loyal, very loving, very genuine, very sincere, and you both care for each other. Whether you go around the fire four times and get married and then become intimate, or you get intimate without that, what difference? Tell me, ask me, ask yourself, what difference? The difference would be simply society recognizes you as a couple. In this other case, society doesn't recognize you as a couple. If you are happy to live with that, good luck to you. That's why always keep your thinking, your rational faculty fully switched on when you're addressing these issues. Now, what about this idea about girls have to be virgin? This is not only for Hindus, it's been throughout the world. You know, they must make sure the girl is a virgin, otherwise she can't get married. And every society, not only Hinduism, every society has been imposing this.
It's a bit of double standards, isn't it?
It is very much double standard, and the reason is very simple. It reflects a patriarchal, means a male-dictated society. So when there's a male-dictated society, they'll impose this thing. The girls have to be pure and pristine, the boys can mix about. So this is, if you like, highly, you know, a very highly biased system of thinking, and it reflects a patriarchal society. But society has moved on now very fast. And the women are now coming back in force, and I'm very happy to see them taking up, rolling up their sleeves and nothing doing.
So quite offensive, this kind of thinking to a modern woman now.
It is indeed.
Brilliant. So folks, thank you so much for joining the conversation. I'm now going to move over to your comments online, and I'll start asking the questions. Welcome to Vipin Kumar, watching us from India, Delhi. And he says that the character that passes from one life to another, who carries this character? Is it Atman? If it is Atman, then why would Atman want to take up new bodies, and how does it decide which body to take up?
You see, Atman, as I said, there are two ways of looking at it. When you think about Atman, is the spirit underpinning the reality. You know, nothing to do with you, nothing, another tiddly fellow guy. That's not Atman. That's called Jivatman. First, make the distinction between Atman and Jivatman. Let me tidy up. Most Hindus are confused about this. When you say soul, the nearest Sanskrit term is Jivatman. So you might think Jivatman seems to be bigger than Atman. It's a bigger, longer word. Jivatman is a very limiting word. Jivatman says, when the spirit appears, remember the word is appears, is encapsulated in the body and mind, it is called Jivatman. Means Atman appearing, kind of getting caught up in a body and mind complex. Just appearing in the body and mind complex is called Jivatman. That Jivatman has a character, it develops, it goes through ups and downs, it is born, it dies, Jivatman comes and goes. But the underpinning spirit that was kind of, you know, shining out through this little mind and body complex, that doesn't come, that doesn't go. Atman is never killed, doesn't die with the body. So that part, it doesn't have a character. It is, we all know this kind of outer characteristic, that is a characteristic of Jivatman. The body and mind, especially the mind complex, will in a way color. the way you look at an individual and his character, that keeps changing, that keeps getting, you know, kind of chiseled throughout his life. That moves around. But the underpinning, we just said, that's why I say Jivatma is an appearance. That has ups and downs and character and misbehavior and all that. But the underpinning, Atman, remains pure and pristine. Unfortunately, we cannot make the distinction between Atman and Jivatman. That is why we are in trouble. The moment you can see yourself not as Jivatman but as Atman, you are released from all these kind of bondages, including your own limitations.
Brilliant. Thank you so much. Welcome to Naina Singh watching us from Fiji. Welcome to Gopa Kumar watching us from Kerala in India. And this ties in to another question. Does moksha result in the end of the cycle of birth and death? And if yes, where does the Atman go then after death?
As I told you, Atman doesn't come, doesn't go. Jivatman comes and goes. At the time of moksha, Jivatman in a way, the knots that was tying up this Atman with this kind of mind and body complex has been severed, demolished. So that Atman never come, doesn't go. But Jivatman, kind of this appearance, kind of makes itself visible in the world, and this appearance in a way then dissolves. That's another interesting issue that I can touch on it when we are talking this. People say, Mr. Lakhani, you know, we believe in the big bang, where the whole creation starts, beginning of kalpa, wonderful idea, philosophically satisfying. And we also believe in big crunch, means everything disappears. Whew, everything, one of these cosmological arguments that at some stage, the whole thing that is expanding will start to go back in reverse and collapse, and this becomes nothingness, disappearing into nothingness. So they say, Mr. Lakhani, but all these jivatmas, you know, struggling to get moksha, what will happen to them? This is a very interesting question. There are trillions of living things, you know, kind of struggling. What happens to them when suppose the universe comes to a crunch, boom? What happens to all these things? They are floating. Where do they go? What happens to them? The answer is this. They were never here. There was only an appearance that they are here and struggling and making, how these animals and humans and with different characters, there was an appearance. That appearance disappears. This is the way to think about whatever happens to people who are only halfway towards moksha. Nothing happens to them. They were never here anyway. Their particular illusion disappears.
Brilliant. We've got lots of questions, Jaybhai, today. So one is from Siva Chetty. He's saying, how does a Hindu react to other Hindus performing some ridiculous rituals in the name of Hinduism?
With smile, I would say. I'm not saying participate. If you think, it's happened to me. When I was somewhere, you know, outside in the country and I was being interviewed, somebody said, but this is really true, this happens, you know, on this particular night and there is special magnetic. I said, look, madam, leave me alone. I will not listen to this thing because it doesn't agree with my common sense. Always keep your rational faculty switched on. People do weird things in the name of religion as well as in non-religion. You know, even in secular world, people have got a habit of doing weird things. And we just smile and carry on. I mean, as long as they don't offend you, they don't jump on you and say, force you to participate, you can smile and just walk away. So my advice is, if people are doing weird things that you feel have nothing to do with religion, then people, all human beings do it. Not only in the religious field, but even in the non-religious field, we do weird things in the secular world. So this is the way of the world. It's a very weird world, but it's fun. Another thing I must mention is this. Somebody said, Ms. Lakhani, I keep getting offended with people. They get in my way and I get really upset all the time. I'm feeling upset all the time. How do I get over it? I said, the trick I use is as follows. When I find some highly offensive person interacting, of course, they're trying to interact with you and cannot
wind you up.
It happens all the time. First reaction is, oh, how dare they? They are really interfering. They are, you know, nuisance. I see them as intrusion in my life. Next moment, I tell them, hang on. What is happening? In reality, that individual who is a nuisance is in a way reaffirming that you exist. Ah, I exist. Oh, he's reminded me I continue to exist. So rather than focus on what exists or how nuisance it is, tell yourself this nuisance fellow is making me realize, reaffirming my speciality. I exist, my friend. So when you focus, because it actually works, try it. You know, you always find somebody in the queue, kind of jumping the queue and doing all sorts of things, you know, in every field of normal life. Every time somebody kind of steps on your toes like this, there's, ouch, it reminded me I exist. And when you do that, you don't see that person as interfering, but reaffirming your sacred dignity. So this is the way you turn the issue around.